Over the past few years, I've been working to migrate as much of my digital life as possible off of Google services. I've mentioned this in a few past videos, and so I wanted to create this video to share a little bit more about why I am doing this, as well as how. My interest was first sparked in this by a tweet by Zach Gage. He is an indie game developer who I really like his games. I think he's an interesting person. And he had posted about different services that he is moving off, so popular services he is leaving, and the alternatives that he's moving to. This was the first aha moment where I had the realization that there were viable solutions to many of Google's services that were currently on the market. I started thinking more critically about my own internet usage and if it was sustainable and whether it reflected my own values. Also, as I mentioned, I wanted to make sure that there were quality alternatives, because as much as philosophically I might want to leave Google services, it would be very difficult to leave for a worse product. Like, I've become spoiled by quality products, and so I wanted to make sure that the market had options for me, and I think that we're finally at a point where there are some really good, really viable alternatives to Google services that makes leaving actually practical. Like, leaving Google is actually a practical thing that you can do now. In terms of the reason why I am leaving Google services, there are two main reasons. The first is Google's ubiquity. It is everywhere. And the second is its monetization structure. So first, to touch on its ubiquity, it makes me sort of nervous to have one company run every single aspect of my digital life. And with that comes lock-in. So the effort cost of leaving is higher the longer that you're there. It becomes really hard to replace. You are totally at the whims of the company and what they decide to build or what they decide to just kill off as a product. Also, because Google services are free, there is very little support. So if you have a problem and you want to contact support, it's just really difficult to do that. You don't really have any numbers or any chats or anything that you can really call with Google services. In terms of the way Google is monetized, it is almost completely ad-supported. Like the rest of the web, which we can argue whether that was a mistake or not. But when a company or when a service is ad supported, it means that you are the product, you are not the customer. So you are the product, being your information, your usage, your everything is being sold as the product to the customer who is an ad buyer. And I think a much better business structure is for me to be the customer. And so for the company to try to improve the experience for me, the customer, because I am paying them money, versus them trying to improve the experience for advertisers or improve the experience in order to sell more ads. It just is at odds with having a quality product. And I think over the years, we've seen it play out, and the quality of Google services has sort of gone down as more advertising has become a bigger source of revenue and more of a monster in its place across our entire society and internet culture. But with all my idealism about Google and why I'm leaving, I'm also a realist. And like I said, I wouldn't want to leave a Google service for a worse version unless the benefits of using that were so much greater. But for a long time, I really didn't mind if something, I didn't mind trading some of my privacy and some of my usage history in exchange for using a better product. But now that we've gotten to a place where a lot of the alternatives are as good, if not better, it really caused me and might cause you to think about that cost-benefit analysis and whether it is still true that you would rather trade your data for a free service, which it very well might be. I say for 99% of people, that will probably still be the case, or whether, at least for specific services, the cost-benefit analysis is there where you would rather trade money in exchange for a different service. And especially when that service is better, that might change your calculus as well. This video does not cover every single Google service. That would be insane. There are way too many Google services to cover every single one in a video. Instead, I've chosen 10 that make up probably about 95 to 97% of my own usage, and very well might make up the same percent for you as well. and I put them into four different categories. One is completely replaced, so what I'm using now instead of Google. The second is what I would replace if I cared enough, so there are viable solutions, but they just aren't right for me for whatever reason. The other is where I have partially replaced. And the final category is where I am staying with Google. Spoiler alert, it's YouTube. You're watching this on YouTube, but I'll show you some of the other services that I've left coming up next. So let's jump into those Google services. The first Google service is Google Search. Ubiquitous, everywhere. You go to google.com and you type in a search term. And I have left this. I no longer use Google Search in favor of a search engine called Kagi, K-A-G-I. And Kagi is a privacy-first premium in that it's paid, a search engine that is absolutely fantastic. I was surprised when I used it that the results could be as good as they are. So for a while, I decided to try DuckDuckGo. So I set it as my main search engine many years ago, and it lasted maybe a month before I came back to Google Search. The problem was I just couldn't find what I wanted when I was using search, and the quality just wasn't there. And so I went back to Google. Then I discovered Kagi. I discovered it because of that tweet by Zach Gage, and I gave it a try, and I was pleasantly surprised to see that the search results were better, and I was finding more of what I was searching for. And so I kind of had an aha moment that, oh, I could viably leave Google Search in favor of Kagi. So I signed up for their paid plan. This has been over a year now, and I have not gone back to Google at all. I think Kagi is, as I said, better than Google Search. I really love a lot of their features like lenses. I use their assistant. There's a lot of different things with Kagi that I really love, and I just can't see going back to Google Search. The next Google service is Gmail. So I have left Gmail completely in favor of Proton Mail. So Proton Mail, like Kagi, is a privacy first product. So the email that really comes with privacy first. I wasn't sure about it being a primary email address. I feel like a lot of people use it as a secondary or a privacy-based secondary email address, but it's fantastic. It is definitely a good replacement for Gmail for me. I use it as my main email. I use it with my own private domain, which is nice because you can use a custom domain. And if you were using a custom domain at a different email service, you can just bring that over to Proton. And so far, I'm happy with it. I'm not totally using a lot of the other Proton services. So they have Calendar, they have Drive, they have a VPN, which I do use sometimes. But I would say the big one is email. And I've definitely been able to leave Gmail in favor of Proton Mail 100%. The next is the Google Chrome browser. So I was using Chrome or a Chromium-based browser. I used to use Brave for many years. I had a lot of muscle memory. I had it set up, customized exactly how I like. But Kagi was so good with the search engine that I knew they had a browser. I kind of waited more than a year before switching, but I decided to give Orion a try. And this was maybe about 4 months ago, and I've been super happy ever since. I do not miss Google Chrome or Chromium browsers at all. Orion supports plugins from both Firefox and Chrome. It has a lot of features that match Safari, which I think Safari is the best feature set for browsers, even though it's not my favorite browser at all. I really like Chrome, but now I can say I really like Orion. I'm actually using it on both my laptop as well as my phone because they have a browser for both. And again, super happy. It's not something I really think about. Once you kind of got used to the new browser and my muscle memory was there, I just didn't think about it. It blends into the background, which honestly is what I want from a browser. So very happy to not be using Google browser in favor of something else. And that something else is Orion. Next up is Google Photos. And Google Photos, I've completely left it. So I have a replacement, but I want to give an asterisk because the replacement is not just worse, but significantly worse than Google Photos. So Google Photos might be a service that you still want to stay on. But for me, I'm only really using it to back up my photos on my phone and then browse sometimes, because Google Photos browse and search feature is just fantastic. It's really great. And this replacement is not, but it backs up my photos. I don't use search that much. And so what I am using instead of Google Services or Google Photos is PhotoPrism. So PhotoPrism is an application that is self-hosted. So I am running it on a home server in my apartment. And so that's running on my home server. All the photos are backed up on a Synology NAS, and I am using an app called PhotoSync on my phone, which sends all of my photos to PhotoPrism. And the setup is really great in terms of peace of mind that all of my photos are backed up, and I don't have to rely on a Google service to use AI to understand what is in my photos and then serve it to me via search, which is kind of creepy, but yeah, the product just isn't there. So this is a hit or miss. I've completely left this Google service, but you may not want to. Next up is Google Calendar. This one is easy. I'm just using Apple's version, which is iCal. One of the downsides is that when I get invited to an event via email, so I get it to my Proton email address, it definitely does not automatically add to the calendar. That's now a manual process, which if you're using both Gmail and Google Calendar, you might be spoiled by the fact that they're intrinsically linked because it just fits together so naturally. But it doesn't work that way if you're using different services. And over time, I sort of like that I have to be manual and mindful with events that I'm adding to my calendar. So this was a con for a while and sort of made me regret switching. But at this point, I'm sort of happy that I'm manually doing it now. But just keep that in mind if you are planning to leave Google email, so Gmail, as well as Google Calendar. The next Google service is Google Drive. And I am putting this in the category of partially replaced. So as a backup tool, I no longer use Google Drive. As a backup tool, I'm using my own self-hosted option. So like I said, I have a Synology NAS that just runs in my apartment. And all of my important files, I back up to that. And that is redundant on the NAS, and then I also back that up to the cloud. Google Drive is just hard to get away from because it's fantastic for sharing files. It's fantastic for getting files from people. And so for those uses, I'm still using Google Drive because I have a free Gmail account and it's free. I know that the Synology NAS has similar options, but they're just a little bit more clunky and not as nice as Google Drive. And so I just know that I don't put anything sensitive or I don't put anything important on Google Drive. So I treat Google Drive storage as sort of ephemeral, and anything important, I just manually store myself on my Synology NAS. The next Google service is Google Maps. And again, this is in the partially replaced category. When I am browsing on the internet, on my laptop computer, definitely Google Maps. It's the best. There is an Apple Maps app. I don't like it as much. The website for Google Maps reigns supreme. But on my iPhone, on my phone, Apple Maps is vastly superior to Google Maps. And I feel like a lot of iPhone users still use Google Maps. And I would encourage you to revisit that, mostly because when Apple Maps first launched, it was terrible. And it caught a reputation for being bad. And I think that reputation stuck with them despite every single year improving until it got as good as Google Maps, and then it surpassed them. This was many years ago now. So if you are an Apple iPhone user and you're still using Google Maps, I would encourage you just to try it. Switch over to Apple Maps. It's much more integrated into the system. The directions are fantastic. The user interface is better than Google Maps. And you might be a convert. You might not, totally up to you. But for me, I feel like Apple Maps is so much better than Google Maps on the iPhone. But website, I'm still using Google Maps. Next up is Google Docs. This is in the category that I would replace if I cared enough. I don't use Google Docs enough to really care. But there is a cool alternative called ButterDocs that I've heard great things about. I think it's like $100 a year as of the time of this recording. And if you're a big Google Docs user, you have Teams, that sort of stuff, definitely check out ButterDocs. But for me, I just don't care enough, so I'm using Google Docs still. Next also is Google Analytics. This is another in the category that I'm still using Google Analytics. If I cared enough, I would switch to something like Plausible or Matomo, I think it's called. But I don't care enough, It's free. I don't mind, I guess, giving all of my website data to Google. They might as well have it, but it gives me some of the visibility I need for my website, and that's good enough. And lastly, number 10 is YouTube. Spoiler alert, because you are watching this, I am still using YouTube. There is no other viable alternative for video sharing and community and stuff like this. So I'm still using YouTube, and I mean, I don't mind it. I wish the ads were better, shorter, more conscientious, but YouTube is what it is, and I think it's here to stay. And that's it for this video. I hope you understand a little bit more about the reasons why I'm leaving Google and have left, and maybe got some inspiration. Maybe you learned of a couple of new services that you might want to check out. If you've enjoyed this, please give it a thumbs up, give it a like, all of those YouTube-y things that everybody says. And with all that said, I will see you in the next video.